The players in my current 40k inspired D&D campaign were traveling through the great eastern plains of the continent of Horus. Their mission was to barter for peace with the chief elders of the Dao tribes that lived all throughout the Great Plains. Several villages of the Church of the Emperor had recently been raided by the Dao as a response to several attacks that were accidentally caused by the players. While their intentions were good, they understood that they would have to be on guard as they traversed the Great Plains. What I prepared for them was an encounter I so elegantly called the Tiger Encounter. Walking through the plains, the party will come across a crouching tiger. The start of the encounter will play out differently if the party is going stealth or is simply walking through the plains. The reason I designed this encounter this way is because I noticed that in previous sessions, there was always one player that would always try to stealthily walk through everything. Of course, he was the rogue. If the party decided to send that scout ahead, or if all the party decided to stealthily walk through the encounter, I would ask them all to roll a perception test and give them an idea of how much they would see. The way I sometimes like to run perception checks is to have everybody roll, and I start off with the person with the lowest roll and give him a snippet of what he sees, and then move on to the next person, give that person a little bit more information until I get to the highest roll, and I give that much information to that person. Whether he wants to share that with the rest of the party, that's up to him, but the reason I like to do this sometimes is because everybody gets a little hint as to what's going on, and then at the same time, it just creates some type of suspense. For this encounter, all the players that rolled 1 through 5 would see a prey animal grazing around tall grass. The animal is a four-legged antelope creature with two bright red glands on either side of its throat that vibrates as the creature breathes. If a player rolled 6 through 10, I would let them know that about 80 feet away, they would see movement in the tall grass. They wouldn't be able to tell if the movement came from the wind or if there was an actual creature moving around. Moving on to the 11 to 15 roll, they would see the silhouette of a large creature moving through this tall grass, and it would slowly approach the prey animal. And then finally, for all my 16 to 20 plus rolls, they would actually be able to tell that it's a large tiger stealthily walking towards the prey, its yellow stripes blending into the tall grass, making the tiger disappear and reappear ever closer to its victim. After I've painted the picture, I ask the party, "What do you want to do now?" If the party does anything to alert the prey animal, such as move towards the tall grass, shoot an arrow at the silhouette, or make a noise to warn the animal that the tiger is near, the tiger will pop his head up, stare directly at the party, and roar. The party will then roll a wisdom saving throw. I based the wisdom saving throw on the tiger's intimidation. I checked the monster manual, added the bonus, did the roll. You can come up with whatever number you want. If a party member passes, then the party member stands up and they're ready to fight. Roll initiative. If the party member fails, the party member is now terrified of the tiger and is frightened so much that they must roll initiative at disadvantage. Now let's back up a little bit. If they decided to allow the tiger to hunt, or they didn't act on the moving tall grass, describe how the tiger shoots out of the tall grass and in a show of raw power tackles the prey animal to the ground. It bites down on the back of the creature's head, and the party hears a crunch as the spine snaps. The tiger then drags the creature's carcass to a nearby tree that just so happens to be directly in the middle of the path where the party should be going. The tiger lays down and begins to eat its meal. Now the party has one of two options. They can do something to attack the tiger or try to move around it. If they decide to attack, capture, distract, or do anything to scare the tiger, treat the whole thing like any normal combat. The tiger should be about 60 to 80 feet away and doesn't want to give up its meal. If they decide to stealth their way out of this, roll a perception for the tiger against the party stealth. If anybody in the party fails, the tiger will see them as a danger to his kill and will attack. Roll initiative. If everybody manages to pass, then congratulations, the party just evaded the whole combat encounter.
Psych!
I come from playing 40k, and in 40k there is only war. A portal to the warp opens up, and a greater demon of Khorne steps into D&D. He roars,
"Blood for the blood god, skulls for the skull throne."
In all honesty, you could decide to allow your players to pass the encounter with zero combat, but not just yet. Because the best thing about D&D is the fact that you are in a fantasy world full of the extraordinary, and this is no ordinary tiger. He is actually a druid in tiger form, and he is not alone. If the party passes through without detection, a second tiger will exit the tall grass and stand in the middle of the party's path. Staring intently, the second tiger will approach, and before the party can make any attack, the tiger will revert back to his true form. The tiger feasting on his kill also turns back into his true form, with his mouth covered in blood. What you do next is completely up to you. You can have the party fight the Druid Brothers, talk to the Druid Brothers, whatever fits your campaign. In my situation, these two Druid Brothers were going to feed information to the party. Now, let's go all the way back to the beginning. If the party decided to walk through the plains with no stealth at all, then I would roll for a tiger's perception check. If they rolled pretty bad, let's say 1 through 6, then the tiger wouldn't see the party, and it would jump to the stealth scenario, where they roll perception, they see the antelope, all that good stuff. If the tiger's perception roll was high, then the tables would turn, and the tiger would notice the party before the party noticed the tiger. He would ignore the antelope or the prey animal completely, and he would begin to stalk, stealthily stalk the party. As the party is strolling along, I would ask them to give me a perception check and compare it to the tiger's stealth roll. If everybody in the party fails, then they are so distracted that a second tiger has now noticed the party and began to stalk them. If at least one party member manages to beat the tiger's stealth roll, then they sense that they are being followed. To avoid having them roll two perception checks, use the same perception roll that they just rolled and give them more information. If they rolled a 1 through 5, they see a prey animal off in the distance running away. It might have been the party that scared it off. If they roll a 6 through 10, they see movement in the tall grass, approximately 40 feet away behind them, the exact distance needed for a tiger to pounce. On a roll of 11 to 15, they see the silhouette of a large creature moving through the tall grass, coming towards them. For anything higher than a 16, they see a large tiger walking towards them. More than likely, the party's going to attack the tiger because it's a menacing creature that's walking towards them. Roll initiative and begin combat. Whenever this encounter turns into a combat, the second tiger will appear after the first round of fighting. And if any of the two tigers are reduced to 0 hit points, then they will revert back to their true druidic form. Once they revert back to their true form, you could either continue the combat as them fighting a druid, or you can use the druid as a way to speak to the party and kind of calm things down or figure out what's going on now that he has the ability to actually speak. Now let me tell you what happened when I ran this encounter. The party, contrary to my beliefs, did not go into stealth. They decided just to walk on by. I rolled for the tiger's perception. The tiger did perceive them, and the tiger began to follow them. I asked him to roll for perception just to see if they noticed something. Turns out the party did notice the tiger, and I let them know, "You're being followed by a tiger," because their perception roll was so high. The party then just looks at the tiger. I let them know, "The tiger is coming towards you guys, ready to pounce." Contrary to my beliefs, party does nothing. "The tiger is getting closer. Its claws are coming out." Party does nothing. At that moment, I was encountered with a huge dilemma because I knew that the druids had information that the party was going to need. And on top of that, the druids weren't evil. They were just out and about, and they were going to attack the party because they felt like they were being attacked because they were tigers. The party didn't attack the tigers, so in that situation, I had no option but to revert the tigers into their true form and to share the information. Deep down inside, I wanted it to be a combat phase because, again, I'm a 40k player. I want war, constant war. But the party didn't want that. So I just allowed the party to talk to the two druids that ended up helping the party to learn more about a coming threat. With that said, that was the tiger encounter, my very first D&D encounter video. More videos to come. What I'm going to try to do, or what I am going to try to do, and you could expect this from the channel, every Saturday I'm going to post an encounter D&D video. Next week, I'm going to be talking to you guys about the Room of Soundless Void. It's an encounter that I ran 2 weeks ago with the same party, and they had a lot of fun, and I want to tell you guys what the room is all about. But the reason that I want to start creating these D&D encounter videos is, number one, to share my thoughts and my encounter ideas with you guys. Hopefully you could use them in your campaigns. If you change anything up, or if you would change anything up, comment down in the comment section below. Let me know how it went for you. And then the other reason that I want to create these videos is because I am a war gamer. I come from 40K, so there are a lot of things that I've noticed with DMs that aren't or don't have the wargaming background. They're usually missing some type of challenge level, usually found in combat, that a wargamer just naturally has. So I want to share my encounter ideas with you guys so that it can help your campaigns, and at the same time get feedback from all the experienced DMs and help me build non-combat encounters, just because I want to improve my DM skills and at the same time try to improve the community with what I know from playing war games all my life. So again, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. More videos to come. Subscribe to the channel. Tell your friends that we're creating D&D content now. And yeah, can't wait to talk to you guys in the comment section. With that said, I'll talk to you tomorrow. This is Gershwin with One Mind Syndicate signing out. Put my freedom first in any